The First Woman is a novel set in Uganda in the 1970s, and it's about a little girl who lives with her grandparents. They love her very much and she's spoiled, but at the same time she doesn't know who her mother is. She knows her father, but she doesn't know who the mother or where she is. And so when the book opens, she's decided to find her mother, because at one point she feels like she flies out of her body. And if she flies out of her body, then something is wrong with her. Then she must find her mother to explain. But on this other side, she's frightened that perhaps she doesn't know her mother because she abandoned her, because she flies out of her body. And perhaps she is a witch. So she, when the book starts out, she's going around asking people who her mother is, because her family are not really telling her who her mother is. It's mainly about showing that feminism has been around in Africa for a very long time, because we all believed the feminism came in the 1970s, that actually Chirabo, the main character, while we see her being a feminist, but her aunties are, and her grandmother is, and her grandmother's best friend, Nsota, is, but also Nsota's mothers, who are, would be her grandmothers, were. And I wanted to show the different ways different generations did it. One, because there's this belief that as women we have failed to pass on feminism to our daughters, to our grandchildren, you know, while the patriarchy is so fantastic as at passing it on, you know. So for example, in Uganda, when you have a son, the first thing you say, you're going to be a man, you're going to be a fighter, you're going to devour the world, and you're going to be a hunter. Before, the girl was like, oh, you better be beautiful so that you could marry a good. So I wanted to talk about how to pass on our ideas of feminism. And sometimes you find that between the generations, so for example, my generation believe that my mother's generation were too weak. They didn't fight hard. They let their husbands walk all over them. But at the same time now, my nieces are like, auntie, what kind of feminism is that? Because sometimes I'm like, come on, easy on the boys, go easy. And I'm like, it's you who spoiled them because you're mothering them. So in a way, there's a disconnect between the generations. So what I was trying to do was to say, look, this is how traditional feminism has been passed on. So you have a grandmother called Nsota. She takes a little girl who's 12 years old and says, okay, this is the ABCD of feminism. This is why we started. This is what it was like. And this is where we are. But how do we undo it? So all of that, by showing the different women, I was trying to show how we can work on passing on feminism. And also at the same time, because I'm talking about indigenous feminisms in Uganda, I wanted to say that the way you see feminism in the West might not be the way we do in Uganda. So in the West, you focus a lot on the big figures of feminism, okay? You focus on the manifestos, the theories, the ideas. At home, feminism is just life. We don't even have a word that is important, because every woman wakes up every morning and goes out in the world to fight. And these are personal battles. Sometimes they win. They push hard and they win. Sometimes they push and they are pushed back. Sometimes they take tactical step back and negotiate. sometimes they cajole. So it's not like militant, winning. No, it's not like that, you know. So I thought, okay, in the West, we focus so much on the big feminism, you know, Susan Sontag, you know, all those figures. But I'm thinking, no. Let's focus on the tiny little woman who works in the market, you know, an unknown person. How do they negotiate? So in the book, you see Chirabo's auntie. So you, her grandmother, her idea of feminism is quiet. You know, negotiate quietly. Nsuta is wild, you know, I'm not going to get married and I'm going to do this. And that is her, that's how she pushes. And then she has Aunt Abby, who's refused to get married and wants to get wealth and, you know, and push like that. And then you have Aunt YA, who is absolutely rich. She makes more money than her husband and then gives it to her and says to her children, oh, your dad worked, so can you say thank you to your dad? You know, all these women are legitimate as far as I'm concerned. None of them should be judged. This is how they find their way of survival. So this is why I showed all of those characters. For a long time in Uganda, motherhood was related to getting pregnant and having a baby. You know, anybody who has been pregnant and had a baby is a mother. If you haven't, then you are not considered a mother. And motherhood is a huge, huge thing in Africa. We have songs about it. Women are celebrated and women are keen to have children, because that's where you find respect and love, okay? But I wanted to say that let's not look at motherhood in these general terms, you know. It's more nuanced, okay? So here's Chirabo. She's being mothered, but she's not aware. Her grandmother worships her. And Suta, down across the road, loves her very much. And a lot of the women in the village, they take care of her. She's fed up with it, you know. But most of all, she has Aunt Abby, who's loved her all her life, you know. But she takes all those people for granted. So she goes out to find her mother. Where's my mother? I'm not loved, you know. And she's so disturbed and so hurt. And, you know, she goes out of the way to be, to find the woman who she was in her womb and therefore produce her, because she believes that woman would love her. So it was very important for me to show an array of different women. So in the village, she's loved by all these women. But then she moves from the village and meets her stepmother. And it's a very different ball of game, you know? And that pushes her harder to find her mother. But Aunt Abby just loves her, you know. She just pushes it aside until she finds her mother. And at that point, she's forced to stop and look back and see all those women who have loved her, you know. So I wanted to talk to my society that let's look at mothering differently. You know, anybody can have baby-making machines and produce a child, but how many people are actually are mothers? And those are the people that we should be celebrating. So it was very important to me to talk about mothering.